الحمد لله الذي أحسن كل شيء خلقه وبدأ خلق الإنسان من طين وأصلي وأسلم على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، ألا وإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. I bear witness that there is none worthy of our worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the seal of the prophets and the final messenger to all of humanity. Whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides, there is none to misguide. And whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala leaves astray, there is none to guide aright. وبعد فنحمد الله سبحانه وتعالى الذي بلغنا رمضان. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and thank Him for giving us the opportunity and the health to fast in this month. It's a ni'mah, it's a blessing that deserves gratitude from us to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I know some people in the community who are not able to fast in this month, either because they are very old or they are very sick. Some sisters are pregnant, they are not able to join us for the fast in this month. So if you are here, you are fasting, you come for Salatul Jum'ah, you are one of the lucky ones. So you should say Alhamdulillah. I know some people back home, they are fasting in this month and they are not sure if they will be having food for iftar at Maghrib time. A few days ago, a friend of mine was giving out boxes of about 20 kilograms of rice and pasta and oil and sugar, tea, all the requirements for iftar in the month of Ramadan. And he said that some of the families who were receiving the boxes, they started to cry because they couldn't believe themselves that they had something to eat at Maghrib. What is our excuse? We should always say Alhamdulillah, we're lucky here. Some people, and I know some of them, they wish they could come to the masjid for Salatul Jum'ah or come for Taraweeh, but they can't because they are either at the hospital or they are at home, they cannot come here. They are too old, they are too sick, they cannot come here. Some people, they do come to the masjid, but they cannot do sajda because they have to sit on a chair. I remember a few years ago, I visited a brother and he was very sick and he had to stay in the hospital for a long time. And I asked if there was a wish that he had, and he said, I have only one wish, because he was sleeping on his bed, he couldn't move. He said, my only wish is to be able to make sajda to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but I can't. So you are lucky to be able to come and fast and to observe the month of Ramadan. I know some people who took shahada recently, their families are against it, they cannot practice to the best of their ability, and no one is fasting around them, and they're struggling with their families. What is your excuse? I don't think you have any excuse, right? So this is something that deserves gratitude, that we should always say Alhamdulillah for giving us this favor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, when I think of the month of Ramadan, I think of a story from a First Nation grandfather who was sitting with his grandson, and they were talking, and he told him, I feel like there are two wolves fighting inside my heart. One of them is a good wolf, and the other one is a bad wolf. So the grandson asked, which wolf do you think will win at the end? So the grandfather said, the one that I keep feeding. This is the one that will win. We as human beings, we're not angels, we're not shayateen. But we have forces of good and evil fighting inside our hearts. So if you do your best and you struggle to do your best, to do good, come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, take care of His creation, eventually the good wolf inside your heart will win. But if you don't care, you turn your back on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ramadan, not Ramadan, you don't really care, then eventually the evil wolf will win. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the month of Ramadan, and as I said, we're not shayateen, we're not angels. But we have the two forces fighting inside. And in the month of Ramadan, you feel it. You have an angelic aspect to you, and you have also a shaitanic aspect out there. So for example, we know that the malaika, the angels, the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them, they never eat, they never drink, they never have intimate relations, they are not male or female, they don't produce children. And this is what we do basically when we fast during the day of Ramadan. We don't eat, we don't drink, we don't have intimate relations, and this gives you this angelic aspect. وَيَفْعَلُونَ مَا يُؤْمَرُونَ. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Fajr time, no eating, no drinking, خَلَصْ سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. Maghrib time, you can eat, you can drink, you have the on and off button in your hand, as we mentioned last time, now you are on the driver's seat in your life, you are in control, your desires are not in control. So now you have this angelic aspect in your life. The other aspect, which is the shaitanic aspect, so let's say for example, wasting in the month of Ramadan and wasting in general, this is something that I usually see. People waste when they eat, when they drink at iftar. There's waste generally in their life. So basically when I see kids, you know, they take a full plate of biryani, whatever food they have, and mashallah, half a chicken, this, that, they take two bites because they drink so much soda or water and the rest goes to waste. They take one bottle of juice, they drink one sip, it goes to waste. One bite of the apple, the rest goes to waste. The family is sitting in one room in the house, like in the living room. Why does the light have to be off in the rest of the house? When you brush your teeth before Fajr, for example, why do you have to waste 10 gallons of water, right? Like this waste, you invite five people to have iftar with you, you have five or four members in your family, a total of 9, 10 people. Why do you make food for 25? Khalas, we get it, you are Kareem, Jawadun Kareem, you are generous. And next day, the leftover, nobody's gonna eat it because our kids, like many of them, they don't like leftovers. So you'll end up throwing more than half of, you know, the food that you cooked the day before. You notice with your kids, the first couple of pages and there's kutch books are full, then the rest is empty and they demand a new one. We see it all the time. There is waste, right? So wasting, and this is why when we speak about the shaitanic aspect in the month of Ramadan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He speaks about shayateen in Surah Isra, He says, إِنَّ الْمُبَذِّرِينَ كَانُوا إِخْوَانَ الشَّيَاطِينَ. Those who waste, they're like shayateen. In which aspect? The way it is explained, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed Iblis before he fell from grace. So he brought him closer to the angels. He was not one of them. كَانَ مِنَ الْجِنِ, as we read in Surah Kahf. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought him in the company of the malaika. He blessed him with ibadah and so on and so forth. And eventually, he became arrogant because of this blessing from Allah. And he ended up wasting all his hasanat. Now, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses you with money, with health, with food, and you waste it, what makes you any different? And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making the connection. So now we have those two aspects, the angelic aspect and the shaitani aspect in the month of Ramadan, and you have the reset button in your hand. And this is one of the amazing things about the month of Ramadan. So basically, we have a routine. So you go about your routine, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala breaks this routine 5 times a day when you go for your namaz. 4 or 5 minutes in salah, you break the routine. So now you're away from the money, from the business, from dunya, 5 times a day. On a weekly basis, when you leave everything behind and come here for Salatul Jummah, you break the routine. Every year, when you go for Hajj, or when you observe the month of Ramadan, you break the routine. Now you are in control, you have the reset button in your hand. Every time I have an issue with my laptop or my phone and I call the technician, the first thing they tell me, restart your laptop, khalas, or maybe shake your phone. I don't know, it's like medicine or something. So shake it, restart it, khalas, it will work. The same thing with the month of Ramadan. The month of Ramadan is the restart button, the reset button that you have, like the daily namaz, the 5 daily salawat, the taraweeh, the day of Jum'ah. You have the reset, the restart button in your hand. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the barakah of this month. Ameen, ya Rabbil Alameen, as'alullah. الحمد لله رب العالمين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله ربه رحمة للعالمين. I'm gonna kindly ask you to move up, inshallah, because people are waiting outside. Jazakallah khair. We spoke about wasting your hasanat in this month of Ramadan, either by not doing enough. So Ramadan comes, Ramadan leaves, you're not getting any closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You basically wasted another year and another year and another year. So this is a wasted time. Or maybe you will get the hasanat, as we mentioned last time, and you will be losing them the easy way. You will gain them the hard way, you lose them the easy way. By fighting with people, losing your temper, cussing at people because, I get it, you know, you're not smoking in the month of Ramadan during the day. You miss your chai, coffee, biryani flavored, you know, in this month. So you're struggling inside, and at some point you explode. And if this happens, the Prophet ﷺ says, inside Muslim, you become muflis. You fast, you pray, you do this, you do that, but you cheat this, you lie this, you cuss at that, so you end up with nothing because you are losing your hasanat. The other day in Taraweeh, I mentioned the story of waste, and some of you still hate me from the last khutbah when I spoke about smoking and cigarettes and stuff. Today, inshallah, you will hate me a little bit more. So basically, the story I mentioned, there was this brother, and he was married to a teacher. She's a philosophy major, and this brother, he used to smoke. He smoked a lot, like 2 packs of cigarettes every day. And she told him, you're basically wasting our money. This is waste from shaitan, and she told him the khutbah I gave about shaitan and waste in Surah Isra. So he didn't stop, he didn't quit. So eventually she told him, you spend like $100 on cigarettes every day, you're taking away our money, you're wasting it. I'm gonna take every time you spend $100 on cigarettes, I'm gonna take $50 from your pocket. Still, he didn't quit. So after so many days, she said, this is not working and I have to step up and warn him a little bit more. She told him, every time you smoke, I'm gonna take the $50, I'm not gonna keep them or take them for shopping, I'm gonna burn them in front of your eyes. And she started to burn the money in front of him. For 10 days, every day she was burning $50 in front of his eyes and he was burning from inside. So only then did he realize that he made a big mistake. He divorced his wife and now he is smoking freely. So problem is solved, right? So there are so many different types of wasting and shaitan is very active. And as we say, yes, shaitan is locked up in the month of Ramadan. Where is shaitan? At least now we know that you shouldn't blame shaitan for everything, right? Because he's not here, but we're still doing some bad things. When you look up at the month of Ramadan, you remember the story of Adam alayhi salam. Shaitan was not in Jannah with him. He was whispering to him wirelessly, remotely from outside Jannah. Shaitan is now locked up and now he is whispering to us, do this, do that, and so on and so forth. So unless you are under the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, shaitan will always be distracting you from what is most important. And I'm gonna conclude with the story of Imam Malik and the elephant. I mentioned it in Taraweeh, but I will remind you that we're missing out a big time if we're not taking advantage of this month. Of course, Imam Malik, rahimahullah, he didn't have an elephant. The people of Arabia were not familiar with elephants. Many of them, they didn't see elephants in their lives. Because elephants, as you know, exist in, there's the African elephant, then there is the Asian elephant in India, other places of Asia, but they don't have it in Arabia per se. And this is why when the Muslims opened Persia at the time of Umar radiallahu anhu, and they brought one elephant to Medina, some of the Sahabas were so amazed that they looked at the elephant and they said, أَمِنْ خَلْقِ اللَّهِ مَا نَرَى. Did Allah create this? Because of the trunk and the big ears, so they couldn't believe their eyes. They were so astonished. So now the story of Imam Malik and the elephant. Imam Malik was in Medina teaching Muwatta, and hundreds and thousands of students came to learn from him. And they were sitting in his halaqah, and Imam Malik, from what we know, was so charismatic. وَكَانَ لَهُ سَمْتِ الْأُمَرَاءِ وَالسَّلَاطِينِ. He was very charismatic. He looked like Sultan. People had so much respect for him. So these thousands of students sitting around him learning Muwatta, someone came from the back door and said, guys, there is a circus and someone brought an elephant to Medina, to the city. Every single one of the students ran away to, you know, to see the elephant, except for one student. His name is Yahya al-Layfi. He stayed there. The only one out of all the thousands that came for the halaqa. So Imam Malik said, subhanAllah, and he was surprised that Yahya stayed. And he told him, why didn't you go with the others? Why didn't you join them? And he said, yeah, Imam, I left my country, I left my family, I traveled thousands of miles to come and see Imam Malik and not to see the elephant. I can see it some other time, but I'm here to learn. So now, many of us have elephants in the month of Ramadan that distract you from what is most important in this month. We know we need to get closer to Allah, get your sins forgiven, salah, reading Quran, dua, and so on and so forth. This is your time. If you don't get closer to Allah in this month, then when? So, our elephant could be social media, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, playing video games, sleeping all day long, hibernating like bears, and so on and so forth. There are so many elephants in the month of Ramadan. So I don't know what your elephant is. You know it better than me. So make sure you lock up your elephant in this month if you want to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just like Yahya al-Laythi in the story. All the students of Imam Malik are forgotten, with the exception of Yahya al-Laythi. His chain of narration of Muwatta is the strongest there is. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring us closer to Him, forgive our sins, accept our good deeds, give us the best in this month. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us ikhlas in everything we say and do. Ameen, ameen, ya Rabbil Alameen. Wa salli Allahumma ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.